cover-ups, lies, and in-between, conspiracies, and those who dare to speak the truth. Get ready for a walk on the wild side. Welcome to Parlay with your host, Michael Gray.
Hi guys, welcome to another episode of Parlay. I'm Mike Gray, your host, and we have a really great show for you today. And I thought I've seen it all. Just real quick, you know, I've been in the conspiracy business for 20 years, ever since I left high school or thereabouts. It's been 20 years now, and I was always into conspiracies, and I've always been into conspiracy books and read every conspiracy out there. Or so I thought, until I stumbled upon the flat earth theory. It's weird. I just recently stumbled onto this. You would have thought that I would have read this in other books, but no, I was on YouTube and one thing leads to another. And I see this flat earth conspiracy or flat earth documentary. And I was like, oh, what's this, you know? And then I immediately thought, oh, Jesus, you know, this is COINTELPRO. This is the government putting out crazy information to make conspiracy, you know, conspiracy theorists look like they're loons. So I clicked on a YouTube video of, you know, one of these flat earth videos. And to my horror, they were making some really good points. So I want to introduce you to Mark Sargent. And it was one of his videos that I saw on YouTube. And he made some really good points, and he's here tonight to share that those good points with us. Now, I'm not saying the Earth is flat, okay? Because I don't want to be Baker-acted, all right? And I don't want anyone to, you know, come and commit me. But I am saying that these flat Earth people make some really interesting points, and we know that the maps that we're shown in high school all our life are not real. They're called the Mercator Map. I believe them. Let's get into it. Hey, Mark, you there?
I am here.
Mark, how you doing, buddy?
Good. Thanks for having me.
Oh, terrific, terrific. All right, now, Mark. Listen, man. I'm watching these YouTube videos, okay?
Yeah.
And one of the first things they say is, if a plane takes off. Now, we're all taught in high school or in school that the Earth is rotating. You know, it takes 24 hours. Further to spin, okay? Mm-hmm. We all know that, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And the Earth is spinning one way. It's not, mm-hmm. you know, okay, it's spinning east, correct? Or
At about 1,000 miles an hour at the equator, yeah.
Now, but if you think about it, and the guy makes a good point in this video, that if you take off from a plane from New York to L.A., mm-hmm. It's 5,000 miles. It takes 4.5 hours.
Yeah.
Now, if the Earth is spinning like they say,
yeah,
L.A. should be coming towards the plane, correct?
Yeah. You know, again, you can't have it both ways, you know, because the argument from the math geeks and the nerds is
Mark, take it from there, because
No worries at all.
I'm not as eloquent as you. You tell the audience what I'm talking about.
And it is not one of my favorite arguments, but it does have merit. You know, because initially, you know, I set out to debunk this thing, you know, about 9 months ago. I was just going to smush it into the ground and be done with it. But to your argument there, if the Earth is spinning, you know, and we're not going to talk about east-west. We'll just say, you know, with the spin or against the spin.
Yes.
If the Earth is spinning 1,000 miles at the equator, let's say up towards North America, it's spinning at, say, 700 miles an hour, whatever it is. You know, if you're flying with the spin, that's fine. You're going one direction. People say, well, you know, you're not going extra fast because, you know, gravity's got you locked down. Well, if you're flying the opposite direction against the spin, then gravity can't also have you locked down at the same time. And so, you know, there's a little bit of fudge factor because you've got the jet stream, which always moves west to east. But yeah, it's an interesting argument. The one though that I like more than that one is the centrifugal force argument, which is using the equator. So if the equator is spinning at 1,000 miles an hour, you're standing on the equator, you're moving 1,000 miles an hour. However, if you're standing right on top of the North Pole, you're spinning at 0 miles an hour. So, if you're on a merry-go-round, every kid knows this. It's like, look, if you're on the outside of the merry-go-round, it's trying to throw you off, right? You're literally trying to be thrown off the merry-go-round. But if you're standing in the very center of the merry-go-round, you could stay there all day. Nothing happens. You just might get dizzy. So the question is, if a 100-pound weight weighs 100 pounds at the North Pole, then shouldn't it weigh a little bit less when you get down to the equator? I mean, we're not talking, I'm not saying it's 20 pounds less, but it's got to be a little less. If centrifugal force is in effect, 1,000 miles an hour is a lot of speed, and nobody talks about it. It's again, it's not one of my favorite arguments because people start bringing out the science books and they've had a whole lot of time to prepare. My points go way way beyond that.
Right.
So what do you want to dig into first?
Now, they made a good point also on the video. They made an also good point on the video where the guy in New Mexico, he was in that balloon, high air balloon.
Oh, the Red Bull guy.
Yeah, and he went up like 80,000 feet. It took him 3.5 hours in New Mexico, okay?
Yep.
Somewhere in the center of New Mexico.
Yeah, I saw it.
It takes him 3.5 hours. This is on YouTube. It even made the news. Hold on,
Yeah.
Mark.
Oh, sorry, go ahead.
Because the phone's ringing here. He went up 80,000 feet. It took him 3.5 hours to go up 80,000 feet,
Yeah.
right?
Yeah, I think it was even higher than that, but go ahead.
Yeah.
Still there?
Yeah, I'm here. We're gonna have to edit this because hold on.
Okay, no worries.
We'll edit this out.
Okay.
Cindy, we could edit that part out. Cindy?
Yeah, you're good.
Okay.
Don't worry about
All
it.
right. Yes. The phone was ringing.
Oh, no, no worries.
So the guy goes up 80,000 square feet. It takes him three 80,000 square 80,000 what is it? 80,000 feet?
Yeah, at least. I personally think he hit 100,000 feet, but it doesn't really matter. The point was he
Okay.
went way the heck up there.
Right. 3.5 hours. Now,
Yeah.
if the Earth is spinning like they say,
Yeah.
he should have landed when he jumped out. He should have landed somewhere in the Pacific Ocean. Yet he lands 70 kilometers from where he took off.
And again, it's you're going and granted he was in a balloon, but it's yeah, you're either going with the spin or against the spin, you can't have it both ways, and it's an interesting little globe puzzle that most people just don't look at.
What about the difference between those maps, like the Mercator map and the Peterson map?
Oh, the Mercator map is what everybody's been, seeing. So when they pull the map over the blackboard when going in school, that's the Mercator map. And it doesn't accurately show what the continents look like in respect to each other. And that's been known for a long, long time. It was really designed, for a shipping, sort of promote the European thing. So, like Greenland in the Mercator map looks like it's almost as big as Africa, even though Africa is technically 17 times larger than Greenland.
Right, yeah, and
And South America is huge compared to like Europe, but it looks like they're about the same size.
yeah.
So they've been trying to introduce in schools what's known as the Gall-Peters map. And in fact, there was a TV little segment on it. I think it was The West Wing or something like that. There was a TV show that kind of like, introducing it to the president, trying to get it to, because yeah, they're trying to push it in schools. It's like, look, the maps, even the maps we're looking at, forget about the flat round thing for a second. Even the maps you're looking at are completely wrong geographically. The countries in the southern hemisphere are far, far larger than their counterparts in the north. And it's just something that we take for granted. And that's the perfect example of when you're raised in it, when you go through school and you are shown these things, why wouldn't you believe them? You're gonna take them at face value. Why would anybody lie about something like that?
You know what's funny is when I remember when I was a kid, looking through like biblical type books or ancient books,
Yeah.
ancients believed that the world was flat and surrounded by mountains, okay?
Yep.
It was like the entire world that they knew was surrounded by an entire ring of a mountain range.
Yep.
And then in the middle was water or an ocean, and then the continents were somewhere in the middle there, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. And
it's like, wow, you know.
Yeah, and that model was, you know, and that's what we believed for the longest time, and which is kind of, you know, where I got started was for, you know, if our civilization, you know, our records go pretty continuously back about 5,000 years, for the first 4,500 years, that's what we thought. You know, every religion, you know, Judaism, Hinduism, Buddhism, Islam, and Christianity, they all had their versions of the same thing. The earth was round, it was flat. Or flat-ish, you know, not a perfect flat, which I'll get into later, and that it was surrounded by what was known as, at least in the Christian Bible, the firmament, and that's, you know, that's in Genesis, and they, you know, a solid structure, and which would make sense because if it is a flat enclosed system, you know, like a snow globe, I hate to use that reference because it's too simple, but like a snow globe or a Truman Show reference, you're gonna cover it with something, and that's what they believed, absolutely.
What's beyond the firmament then?
That's the point of contention. You know, and I've gotten into it with several other flat earthers, you know, because, you know, there's some, you know, people ask me all the time, you know, they say, is there space? You know, is there stars and everything? And it's like, well, yeah, you could have stars in space, but the design that I seemed to run into as I was trying to debunk this thing and as I was building it myself was there was so much design efficiency that you wouldn't need it. Meaning, if you're going to build a small system like this, you don't have to put in, you know, real stars and planets out at, you know, millions of light years away. You could just put them, you know, it's a giant, beautiful simulated painting. That's just up there. Now, as far as what's outside of it, if it was me, I'd put more of these. You know,
It's interesting that we learn that when they made the first nuclear bomb, when they tested it at Trinity,
yeah,
they announced, they said, you know, there's a good possibility this detonation could blow out the atmosphere and the entire atmosphere that we breathe could be sucked out into space,
yeah,
or whatever.
Yeah, yeah, but they did it anyway.
And they did it anyway. And then in the 50s, you know, Project Argus, I believe, they detonated three separate nuclear bombs at the edge of space or the atmosphere.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And which proved pretty much that they couldn't blow through whatever they were trying to blow through anyway. And those tests, which is in part of my clues, I think it was the first one, the guide, the Flat Earth Guide, talked about how they started testing in 1958, again, for no apparent reason, you know, just started firing nuclear weapons straight up. And they kept firing. The only two countries that could do it was the United States and Russia, and they did it for 4 years. And they both quit at the same time in 1962. And that's when both countries decided to start their space program, which is dubious at best.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. You know, if they faked the moon landings, which I think they did, you know, you start to wonder if even, you know, there was photos or pictures or film when they were on the Vulcan space lab. Remember that?
Oh, yeah.
See the guy running, you know, going around in circles. And that could have been in a Boeing 747.
They're simulated. They don't use a 747. I think they use a 737. It's called, right. It's called officially, and people can look this up, it's called the Vomit Comet. Because, you know, when the human stomach is exposed to zero gravity, even in a simulation, it's like, you know, like a roller coaster ride. You feel nauseous and queasy. But yeah, after the moon landing, and honestly, you know, if you guys – and if anybody's researched, you know, this – because the internet has just shot that thing full of holes. You know, if the moon landing was absolutely a sham, and it was, I have no doubt in my mind, then what can you trust? What can you believe? I mean, you want to have some fun. Look at the International Space Station interior videos put up recently. Look at the ISS hoax, you know, videos.
Yeah, it's all fake. It's all fake.
Yeah, those are embarrassing. They're so horrible. I was thinking about that last night. You know,
what's funny is there's not even any when you look at it, people will point out, how come there's no, like in a submarine, you have doors that can be sealed in case there's a puncture.
Sure.
Well, in the ISS space station, it's like a long tube,
yeah.
And if if God forbid there's a puncture in the hull,
yeah, they're the screwed.
They're screwed. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And they, and they can't. The simulation, the plane, and oh, and don't think for a coincidence that for a second that it's a coincidence that the all those interior shots are just about the same width as a commercial airliner. Don't think for a second that that's a coincidence. You know, they could make that thing as wide as they wanted, and there's no room that is bigger, that is wider than a commercial airliner.
And you know what's interesting is that it makes so much sense that they passed a law. I remember back in the late 80s, early 90s, that Congress passed a law that everything had to be digitized, or no more analog transmission. Everything had to be digital.
Yeah.
Because that's the only way you could fake, you know, with using green screen. If you wanted to fake something, it was so much easier to, you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Absolutely. You could, yeah, everything
fake
became
it in, fake it in real time, I'm saying.
Yep. Yeah.
No.
Yeah, it made it way, way easier. But yeah, yeah, the entire NASA program, from my point of view, and you may have seen it on my the stuff I put out there, and it's gonna sound again way the heck out there, but sooner or later, you know, the big thing was, you know, up until the 60s, there was still no way to prove that we were on a globe. Everything was just speculated. You know, if for 20 generations we've been passing around globes in classrooms, but there was no pictures. You know, all you had was you know, some math and you know, the occasional ship. But so eventually they had to create, they had to create the space program to take the picture, right? But the picture wasn't real, so the space program wasn't real. But you had to build the rockets just to give, you know, because you can't, again, you can't hand the picture out to people because they're going to say, oh, who took it? So you have to create the space program just to simulate the fact that it was done. And it was very clever, and I give them kudos for it. But.
Well, do you know what they said that Robert McNamara, Robert Strange McNamara, do you know that the Saturn V rockets?
Yeah.
He ordered, when he was in – the last thing he did after Kennedy died, his last act of service or order, he had all the Saturn V tool rocket dies, all the castings, in order to make those – he had them all destroyed. And people were scratching their heads saying, what do you mean it cost millions or billions of dollars to develop that, you know, to make those tools?
Yeah.
The casting dies or whatever.
Yeah.
We can't build those Saturn V's anymore because he ordered them destroyed. Why?
Yeah, bury the evidence. Oh, well, heck, you want to go down that road? Look up, you know, when all the telemetry tapes were lost a couple of years ago. You know, that NASA says, oh, yeah, we misplaced literally thousands, basically all the Apollo mission telemetry tapes. Just lost them.
Yeah.
They're gone. And all our
historic. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. And all our subcontractors lost them too. I was going, really? Everybody lost everything that could possibly, you know, that you never want people to look at, and you lost them. That's great.
Well, when Ron Howard was making Apollo
13,
Apollo 13,
yeah,
he asked NASA for the videos or the film, and they said, we don't have them. They're lost. He's like, what?
Yeah, which, and, you know, again, I don't know if you watched any of the Clues, but Clue 1, The Empty Theater, you know, I am aghast that I am the only person to put this video out there on YouTube, which is, look, we've had, 50 years of movies since the moon missions, and no one's actually done a moon mission movie. How does that even happen? And people go, no, no, you know, there's got to be moon missions. No. No, there wasn't. You had The Right Stuff in 1983. Which was just an astronaut training program movie, and then Apollo 13, which was, you know, the whole thing took place in a capsule. You know, that was one of the cheapest productions you could ever do, and that was it. No one ever made a moon movie, and you can't. You can't do it. They're not going to be allowed to do it because it's too close. It hits too close to home. If a Hollywood studio makes the movie and it's so spot on that you can't tell the difference from the original mission footage, then what are you looking at? And
right.
and they don't even want to risk it because it would raise too many eyebrows. Plus, you'd let Hollywood in on, you know, it's like, hey, you know, there's so many people in the production teams in Hollywood, you know, they'd start figuring it out as well. Go ahead.
I just wanted to get back to, you know, it's funny we were talking about the Bible. And it says that God separated the waters from the waters, you know, the firmament.
Yeah.
Have you ever listened to Credo Mutwa? He's a Zulu shaman.
I have not, but
well,
go ahead.
Well, he talks about what the earth was like before the flood, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And he's saying that there was actually a vapor canopy around the planet, like that you couldn't see the sun back before the flood, that there was a mist up high, and that it perpetually drizzled and rained.
Interesting.
And yeah, and that's what gave the earth – that's why the earth was so – at that time, before the flood, was mm-hmm. very pristine, and it was almost like perpetual spring.
Hmm.
And if you think about it, if there was a cloud mist, it would keep all the – it would regulate the temperatures. Like
sure.
you wouldn't have the extreme heat from the sun.
Yeah.
And you know what I mean? When there's a cloud cover over, you know, it's the temperatures are better. You know, it's not as because the cloud cover keeps the warmth.
Yeah.
You know, especially at night. So, and then the vapor canopy came down and flooded everything.
Interesting. Yeah. Well, and to that effect, you know, in the flat model, you know, if you look and there's several out there, you know, if we want to look at a pretty good one, look at the you know, it's easy to find online, the flat and stationary Earth. It's a pretty decent model from Orlando Ferguson. But to that effect, you know, if the in the flat model, the outer edge has to, you know, is raised somewhat. And, you know, if you look at the Antarctica thing, you know, Antarctica is a steep climb up to 2 miles, you know, and if it's all the way around.
That's right. Yeah, they say that the ice is 2 miles high.
It's 2 miles high, and it stays 2 miles high. It plateaus out. The whole thing is 2 miles high. So if you look at that, well, yeah, let's say you raise the water table 2 miles. Then what do you got? Then you got something like, I don't know, the Great Flood. Because you know, the argument is, well, you know, if there's an edge, you know, the water's going to fall off, ships are going to fall off the edge, blah, blah, blah. Well, not if you raise, you know, the outer edge to 2 miles. Then you got the whole thing covered, and nobody's going anywhere. It's like a shallow kid's pool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So do you think that the firmament or whatever is like a plasma, like the fourth state of matter or –
whatever it appears to be, and there's some disagreements again in the circles that I'm in, which I have not been in for that long. It appears to be impenetrable. If it is plasma, it seems to be something that you can't get past. Which of course, you know, you could argue it's like, hey, well, you know, the Van Allen radiation belts were, you know, announced in 1959, which again, not coincidentally, the same year they sealed off Antarctica forever. It could be plasma. It could be, you know, it could be a form of hard water. You know, it could be a new element that's not even on our table. But whatever it is, no one's getting through it. It appears to be extremely durable, you know, judging by the nuclear shots that went up. And I don't want to get into the debate about nuclear fission right now. But, you know, the second and third shots were 3.8 megaton.
And, right.
You know, that's a big load. You know, those are big hits, especially for 1959, 1960. You know, back when nukes were extremely hard to come by and very expensive.
It kind of makes you wonder about the old story of the Tower of Babel.
Oh yeah, yeah. Which I put in clue number 8. I didn't mention it by name, of course, because I want people to figure it out on their own. But and this is for your churchgoers out there. The Tower of Babel story, you know, that's from Genesis, doesn't work on a globe model. It absolutely makes no sense. You know, that's a kid's argument from Sunday school, and that is, well, where was this tower going? You know, is this tower going anywhere? But on a flat model, on an enclosed model, it makes perfect sense. You know, because there's a goal. You know, it's, you know, we're talking about an older civilization, way older than us, apparently very technologically advanced, that figured out the firmament, figured out, you know, what was going on, and said, you know what, we're gonna bridge this thing, and we're gonna go straight to the top. And you know how that story ended, where it was, you know, the languages were divided and everything was scattered, and but yeah, oh yeah, the Tower of Babel is an excellent story for from the flat model. But nobody, you know, thinks about it. Or, you know, if you know your Bible stuff, that story about the guy that was slain an army by himself, that he asked God to keep the sun in the sky for an extra day. so he could do it in the daylight. And people, you know, scholars would be like, oh, well, that makes no sense because you'd have to stop the rotation of the Earth. But on a flat model, all you have to do is hit pause. That's it. The sun can just stay in the right place, and you can keep there one day, 2 days a week. Makes no difference because, you know, everything is simulated, for lack of a better word.
And you got to wonder, okay, is God a good guy or a bad guy?
Well, you know, you see a lot of both in this world. I mean, honestly, I don't want to get too much into philosophical discussions, but if – you know, without us, this planet's a pretty nice place. You know, it's a pretty great place. You know, we're the ones that seem to be doing the damage to each other. And, but, you know, and everything here seems to be, you know, on an inspirational scale. There's a lot of very beautiful things. And it seems, you know, because people said, well, is it a prison? Is it jail? I was going, well, if it is, it's a one, it's a very comfortable jail. And two, the jail walls have been hidden. So, you know, if it's confinement, then we, you know, 99.99% of the people don't know there's confinement. I may end up changing that, but we'll find out. So.
Well, you know, what's funny is I listen to Jay. I don't know. Do you know who Jay Widener is? Jay Widener. Jay Widener.
Sounds familiar, but go
ahead.
Yeah,
I listen to him a lot. Okay.
Okay.
And he talks about, you know, the tall whites or the what he basically talks about is that every 12,000 or every 26,000 years, like, this Earth has a catastrophe.
Yeah.
And what he was saying is there were human beings who they didn't want to die.
Yeah.
And either maybe they went underground or went to Mars.
Yeah.
And when they – let's say they either went underground or went to Mars or
okay.
Whatever.
I'll vote now, for underground, but go ahead.
Yeah, underground. Okay. So they went underground. They survived the catastrophe and they kept the knowledge. And when they reemerged – they saw that human beings had survived.
Yeah.
But now everything starts at zero. You know, they were primitive. They had no knowledge.
Yeah.
So they want to basically get out of here. Mm-hmm. And they went about to recreate civilization mm-hmm. to you know, have humans build civilization to build the technology to, like, make nuclear bombs, to make CERN.
And HARP.
Yes, yes, right.
To see if a civilization could help them break out.
Yes. Right.
Interesting. That's
now,
an interesting
– now, whether they're demons or devils or djinn or other humans,
yeah.
Who knows? You know?
Yeah, that's not bad. And maybe the reason why we've gone through – because, you know, it's obvious, you know, to many people that, you know, we're obviously not the first civilization that's been in – what I call the enclosure, because, you know, how many cities do you have to find underneath the ocean before you figure out it's like, well, we may be, you know, version 3 or version 4. But yeah, wouldn't that be interesting if there was a group of beings that were just trying – using every civilization that came through here to see if they could come up with a way to get out. That's an intriguing story. I kind of like it and doesn't really clash.
Well, I'll tell you one thing. I just don't – when you read about Jehovah – mm-hmm. I don't think Jehovah's a very nice person.
Well, oh, yeah, well, no, Old Testament stuff is very grim. Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, very.
It's not a happy time. Absolutely. Right. Which part of the reason I think, you know, New Testament kind of, you know, has been the focus
yeah,
as
the late. Gentle Jesus. I like the gentle Jesus better than the Jehovah, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I don't know how Christians wrap their head around they saying it's the same person.
I was raised, you know, born again Christian, and you know, I've kind of fallen away as, you know, as I've learned about the other religions, but I try not to speculate.
Right. I kind of see all religions as really a trap.
Well, you know, I think faith is a good thing. Spirituality is a good thing.
Yeah, love thy neighbor and the golden rule. You
oh,
know,
sure, absolutely.
That kind of yeah, that's all well, you know, but.
But
I just can't see if the Vatican represents Jesus Christ, then I don't want any part of it.
Yeah, you know, men in power. You know, the power corrupts. It's so very easily, especially if you have a lot of people that have good intentions. You know, underneath you, you're saying, you know, we want to, you know, do good things, but the people at the top, you know, it's, you know, what they there's ulterior motives, and that tends to snowball, and, you know, then you get things like, well, you know, the Dark Ages and the Crusades and the Inquisition, and
right.
gets out of hand.
So where do you think, like I said, man, this is one of the weirdest. I think you even called it in your last interview that I listened to, you called it the runt of the conspiracies.
Oh, it's worse that and that was the only word I could.
It is, man, because I've been posting stuff and saying like I emailed a bunch of my friends who think I'm nuts already. Yeah. And I'm like, look, you know, I know you all think I'm crazy, but watch this video. These people make some really good points, you know.
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, I got physically embarrassed every time I even looked at the Flat Earth folder. You know, it was because, you know, for those out there that aren't big into conspiracies, it's like it is the worst. It is the most ridiculous, ludicrous conspiracy there is. But the thing is, you don't know why. It's because it's the only – it's going to sound too simple, but it's the only conspiracy we debunk to children, you know. Right. And you know, you stick – and it's easy. You just stick a globe in a classroom and you let them sit in the classroom until they graduate from school, and that's it. That's all it takes. And even the word flat earth gets this visceral response from people. And so, yeah, when I initially, you know, started digging into it, I was absolutely going to debunk it. That was and just say, okay, I'm going to look at it. I'm just going to, you know, map it out from A to Z. And as soon as I run into something, you know, if I run into a problem at letter F, I'm just going to throw this thing out and say, you know, that's it. I'm done. And it absolutely turned on me. Everything I looked at, it got worse and worse. And then when I started doing the timeline, it got worse. And then, you know, when I started doing the backstory, eventually I had to ask the question. You know, I had to go back to the beginning, you know, because, you know, I had a little globe, you know, that you probably saw in one of my interviews. I was going, when exactly did it become a globe? You know, that was the big thing. It's like, okay, so it was flat for 4,500 years. And then 500 years ago, they said, well, it's probably a globe. And, you know, they say probably because there was literally no way to prove it. And
but here's the thing. What is the point of conning everyone that when we went from it's flat to it's a globe, what was the powers that be's purpose to con us into thinking it's a globe?
To hide the fence, which I covered in video 5, I think, status quo. And it's as easy as this. If you don't hide the borders, then eventually people are going to see the borders, and then it's a control thing. You're going to lose control of them because they're going to follow that. It's an enclosure thing. So where people will, you know, they'll just start asking questions. But more than that, it's let's call it what it is. It's proof of design. And up until now, you know, and I'll talk about this actually in my next video that I'm doing, is. Up until now, look, religion is still just faith. Yet it's very, very strong faith, and lots of people have it, but it's still just faith. You don't have a supernatural artifact to grab onto. And imagine if there was one. And so, you know, years and years ago, it was put into play that, you know what, let's make it to where nobody even looks for the borders. Because remember, if the world's flat, then sooner or later as technology progresses, people are going to get to a point where they're going to start making journeys and pilgrimages on their own to get there. But if it's round, then you're telling them, oh, you can go around all day long and you're never going to find anything. And it worked. It absolutely worked. But it also backfired, in my opinion, because and I learned this as I was going along, that even the elite, and you can pick whatever group you want. You know, there was no doubt in my mind that, yes, royalty from years ago, you know, the Illuminati or the Masonic or the Builder, whatever group you pick, it doesn't really matter. I have no doubt that they knew. But because they couldn't see it either, as it was passed down from generation to generation, it just became – it just kind of, you know, started transforming into myth and legend. So let's say you were a German prince, right? And you're shown this map and it's a flat world. And, you know, it's like, well, your father and your grandfather and his father before him, you know, we're passing this on. And it's like, yeah, Grandpa, I heard the story. It's flat. But what am I going to do? I'm not going to see it. So it doesn't make any difference. And finally – once we started doing steel-hulled ships, and really when the internal combustion engine came on is when they really could start looking for it, they started looking for it. So, you know, they did North Pole in 1926 with Admiral Byrd, you know, legendary in the field. And then in 1920, you know, so once North Pole was done, they sent him down to the South Pole. And from 1926 through 1954, excuse me, he started looking for it. Absolutely no doubt in my mind that's what they were doing. But I don't think they even told him Or maybe they told him.
It's interesting. Operation High Jump, right? Was
1946.
1946, where he goes down there with a – was it an aircraft carrier? And a full-blown
carrier group. 5,000 men.
He actually says we were repelled, okay?
Yeah.
And this was in the textbooks up until, what, the 1960s?
Yeah. Yeah, and then nobody talked about it anymore.
And he goes, well, we went down there and we were repelled. Repelled by who? So now, was it the Nazis? Because there's a lot of people who think that the Nazis went to Antarctica.
It could have been. But my argument is this. It very well could have been. You know, it's fine. You know, if the rest of the remaining Nazi Navy decided to go down there. And you got to remember, we weren't doing explorations down there in the 40s because of the World War. But it's very possible that Germany was doing expeditions down there. Yeah. You know, it's possibly, you know, they found something. You know, there's some speculation. But that part didn't bother me because after Operation High Jump, whatever was down there, they took care of it. It was done. There was no doubt in my mind because the expeditions just kept firing off after that. And
you want to know something funny? I hate to interrupt you.
No, go ahead.
Okay, you know that there's outposts in Antarctica, okay, where the Dutch are there and there's like scientists.
Yeah.
And there's a big plaque, okay? I was watching the show. This was like 10 years ago, 20 years ago.
Yeah.
There's a big plaque and it says, this plaque is dedicated to, you know, all the people that came here for science. And it says to watch the enemy. And the guy looks at the camera and goes, what enemy are they talking about?
Good point.
You know?
Good point. Yeah.
And that was before I knew about Nazis and, you know, them going to Antarctica.
Yeah.
That always struck me as strange. Like, to monitor the enemy, what enemy are they talking about, you know?
Yeah, that's all been stricken from the history books. Whatever happened, you know, all they say is there was Operation High Jump. You know, that's a wiki thing. It's easy to find. There's pictures, and they went down there, full blown carrier group. He was the fleet commander, Admiral Byrd, and something, you know, and then something happened, but that's it. You know, and it's like, you know, and then they just, you know, erased it. Now it's like, oh, they just went down there for peaceful intentions. Like, really, you send a full, you know, an entire aircraft carrier group to the, to Antarctica and that's it. You know, that's all you're going to say, but, you know, that was
for an expedition.
Exactly. And then
send a military force. The only reason why you send the military force is because you think you're going to have military resistance, you know, like you're going to fight.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. But again, whatever they took care of it because the expeditions kept going. And then I think I had two more after that. And then in 1954, which, you know, the famous Byrd interview, which we were so lucky to get, it's on YouTube. You know, please look it up, not just on my channel, but you can look at the full blown interview. Mine's chopped a little bit to get rid of the fluffy stuff they were asking him. But, in that 54 interview, he says, oh yeah, Antarctica is a treasure trove. You know, he goes, you know, there's an entire mountain range made out of coal. You know, there's oil, there's minerals, there's uranium, there's everything. And at that point, what I kind of pieced together was the authority. And when I say authority, I mean, you know, I'm just lumping up, governments, very, very rich people and royalty. But the authority, I think at that point said, well, maybe there is an firmament. You know, maybe there is no edge. Maybe there is no border. So let's just start harvesting Antarctica for resources. And, you know, everyone was down there. You know, all the survivors from World War II, you had Russia, you had Britain, United States, Chile, Argentina, I think New Zealand, Australia, everyone was down there. And then they go down for Operation Deep Freeze in 1955. And, you know, that was going to run from 1955 to 1956. And then something happened. And whatever spooked them spooked everybody so completely that it was, one day it was, you know, we're gonna be in Antarctica for the next 100 years. And then they see it, and it's like, everybody back in the boats. We are leaving right now. and it was, you know, it's that ultimate, you know, it's that Hollywood gag. You know, it's like you see something, you know, we're totally motivated in one direction, and then you see something that is so jaw-dropping. It's like, we are out of here. And, you know,
maybe we are the Lilliputians, and we don't even know it.
Oh, could have been, you know, and there's speculation, you know, speculation. Okay, what do you see? But there's certain things, you know, that we would take care of. So, you know, Godzilla could have been on the ice, and we would have taken care of it, you know, sooner or later. You know, if you could have run into a race of giants, absolutely, you know, could have been, you know, part of that. But, you know, I went with the most obvious thing to me, which was, look, they found the outer edge. And, you know, it's one of those hidden things. So, you know, immediately, because of what happened right afterwards, which was, so 1956, Operation Deep Freeze ends, probably ended, you know, the second they saw whatever it was. And then immediately Russia and America, who were both on the ice at the same time, decided to ramp up their rocket program right then and there, 1957 rocket program. And by 1958, they were both firing nukes straight up. You know, kept hammering, you know, for the next 4 years. 1959, the thing that, again, it, you know, I'm going to touch on it in the next video, which again, most 99% of people don't know. 1959, they closed Antarctica permanently. They closed the entire continent, millions and millions of square miles of energy-rich resources, everything you could ever want. There's no indigenous population. There's no animal life. There's no plant life, as far as you know. And they closed the whole thing down, locked it down, and put a treaty in place to where every country that became technologically substantial decided, you know, they said, no, you got to sign this treaty. You're never going to Antarctica. And it's still in place to this day. And you know how treaties go in industrialized nations. It's like, were you kidding?
Everyone's oddly honoring it.
Yeah, and the oil companies. I mean, look, British Petroleum, Shell, you know, all the mineral companies, Alcoa, any of the mining companies. You're telling me that these guys can't get in there? What are you talking about? They can get in anywhere. They can get into a national park, but they can't get in there. And it's one of those super interesting secrets that people still don't talk about. And and then it just got weirder from there. So
it makes you wonder.
Yeah, go ahead.
If we're really in a prison.
If it's a prison, it's a very well designed one, and it's designed with so many natural negative reinforcements. So, like in a flat model, the oceans just get colder as you go further out. And then you run into icebergs, which discourage shipping. And then you run into a continent, which, you know, goes 2 miles up. You know, then you've got altitude sickness. And, you know, so, and then you've got, you know, however much land between you and whatever else is out there.
Right.
And again, that creates an illusion of choice, which is, well, you know, you're making the decision to turn around on your own. No different than, you know, climbing a mountain. You know, if you climb a mountain high enough, you're also going to get altitude sickness. It's like, oh, I'm going to head back down. So if it's a prison or a jail, it's a soft one because they're not putting bars in the windows, for lack of a better word.
It's interesting that, you know, if the elite know this, it kind of really makes sense why they believe in transhumanism and they want to transform themselves into almost like these Borgs.
Yeah.
These nanite bodies that can, you know, they're like a living Iron Man kind of thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
They believe that they're going to be able to transfer their soul or their mind into these robots and live forever. That's what they believe.
No, I don't doubt it. And really, as far as hiding it goes, of course, it was a natural reaction. Of course they were going to hide it. You know, it's because the world changes even back in 1956 or 1957, if you figure out, you know, where's the top part of the firmament versus the outer part of the firmament. You know, the world changes right away. The world becomes automatically more spiritual. And it doesn't matter what religion you're part of. It immediately becomes God becomes real. I hate to say this, and the one I'm putting out, you know, maybe today, maybe tomorrow, the clue is called Hiding God. Because people, I have had so many people send me things, you know, so much scripture sent from all different areas, and it's like, look, yeah, I mean, you're hiding. Let's call it what it is. You're hiding the builder. You know, it's evidence, and you know, your definition of God. You know, that varies, of course, but, you know, it's
interesting that the founding fathers were, I believe it's called deists. Have you ever heard of this term?
Okay. I haven't. I could look it up, though.
Deist or deists. And basically, they believe that the God, the creator, is some type of architect, and he built the natural world as we know it. as a clockwork type of thing, and that he left, or he left, or she left,
yeah,
or whatever created us left,
yeah,
and that it is up to them to become gods.
Ooh, that's an interesting one. Yeah, you know, and I have looked at some of the Masonic texts as well. You know, I've looked at everything, and yeah, there's an underlying message there that keeps repeating over and over, and they keep hiding it in symbolism. That is, it was built. You know, it was designed with precision. You know, and you know, they talk about the architect, and
it's funny that one of their symbolisms is a ladder up to the sky.
Yeah.
And okay, well, where's that ladder going? And then you could see people descending out of a pocket in the sky, like a dimension, like sure. Angels going up. Yeah, like Jacob's ladder.
Or the one that's hidden in several of their images is the three pillars that hold up the sky.
And it's interesting that, you know, one's called, what is it, liberty, wisdom, and beauty?
Strength, wisdom, and beauty, SWB. Right. Yeah.
And on 9/11, the two towers came down, and they rebuilt the one.
Yeah. 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 There's a lot. Again, this is an idea that is very, very old, and it's everywhere. You know, people say, oh, it's a Christian thing. No, it is not just a Christian thing. There are many texts that mention this. I can't tell you how many people have sent me the Book of Enoch. Like, I've never read it. You know, saying, oh, you know, the book, you know, for those of the people who don't know, a book that was not canonized and put into the Bible, but was up for consideration at some point, along with the Testament of Solomon. And, you know, that book, you know, goes into quite a few details on the layout of the world and you know, how things were built. And go ahead.
In that book, it talks about the 72 fallen angels.
Yeah.
And Enoch is asking God, hey, get them out of here and take them with you. And God's saying, no, I'm leaving them here. And he's like, no, get them out of here. They're going to create too much trouble. And then Enoch puts them in a box.
Yeah.
Did you read that part?
I didn't, but I like it.
Enoch puts them in a box and puts them in a cave, supposedly under a lake, and buries them.
Interesting.
Now, it's interesting that in France, there's a place called Loret Chateau.
Okay.
Where there was a priest who would always go up and down the mountainside looking for something.
Yeah.
And supposedly he found something, and he became very wealthy. And, you know, there's a lot of speculation that he found the box that Enoch had buried. And
really?
And that box was sent to the Vatican. Yeah.
Huh.
And maybe they released those guys. Who knows?
That's really interesting.
Yeah.
I like that. Yeah.
Azamadoff is the name. Hmm. Azamadoff? Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I'll look into that one.
I'll send you that link.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Have you ever seen a guy, he puts out these videos on YouTube, a black child?
No.
Okay.
No, what's he talking about?
Okay. He talks about the reason why they're creating, they have all these satellites up in space or in the higher upper atmosphere.
Yeah.
And they've created Star Wars. Is and they're building these laser-based weapons, Earth-based weapons.
Sure.
Is they're worried they're going to use these weapons against the Second Coming.
Interesting.
Okay. And they believe that they could use these these Earth-based lasers and the space-based lasers, Star Wars, against an invasion.
Yeah, and if I bought into the satellite thing, I'd go with you on that. However, I will say that you might have a point. Yeah, you know, point there because again, not to quote too much, but was the Revelations, and I don't have the verse in front of me. The Revelations quote where it talks about how the civilization on the ground would repel, you know, would attempt to repel. You know, what they called, you know, the Second Coming, you know, and the angels.
And, you know, and it says that they would, and he even goes into that saying that people would look for death and they wouldn't find it. And what he's saying is because transhumanism by that time will already have taken place and there will be a lot of people that won't be the Borgs.
Hmm.
and they can't die. And the only way they can die is by a flame, you know, by a
incineration.
Incineration, yeah. Mm. So they'd have to melt to die, yeah.
Wow. That's pretty grim.
Because remember, the first thing was a flood, and God said he wouldn't flood the earth again.
Yeah.
That was his promise with the rainbow.
Yeah.
And the second one will be by fire.
Hmm.
The second judgment. That's in the book of Revelation, yeah.
Yeah. No, I've
And it also says that creatures come out of the what was that river?
Oh, Styx?
Yeah. No, not Styx.
Euphrates?
Euphrates River. That yeah. These creatures come out and start eating people. Remember that?
Yeah. Yeah, I didn't know what to make of that, though.
Yeah.
You know, the bottomless pit thing kind of drew me a little bit, but
also, if CERN is real, okay, and they want to open up another dimension.
Yeah.
Just like in the movie Avengers. Did you see the movie Avengers?
Oh, of course. Yeah.
Yeah, where they let in these creatures from another dimension and they
– Yep.
They start pouring in, you know?
Yeah.
It's just yeah. Crazy.
Yeah, CERN has been getting a lot of traction out there. You know, people keep thinking, oh, you're messing with, you know, all sorts of powers. You know the movie line, you know, powers you have no comprehension of, you know, that sort of stuff. Right. For me, if I was designing something like this, I don't know if I would leave the type of household chemicals around that would be able to blow up the house. See what I mean? You know, you would sort of take that into account, because let's put it this way. If super big explosions aren't doing anything, I mean, yes, CERN might have a chance. You know, HARP's been around for a while, and they haven't let anybody in, as far as I know. CERN's got a shot, but you know, we'll see. We'll see. I'm not convinced they can actually do anything yet.
Let's hope not. Yeah, I hope it fails. But you got to
be the optimist on this one.
The amount of money they spent, and for this thing to go through Switzerland and France,
yeah.
I mean, it's enormous.
It is.
Yeah.
It is. And you know, you may be right. You know, maybe they are trying to. Maybe that is the ultimate goal. It's like, okay, maybe the goal has been for the last 50 years, can we, you know, is there a way of breaching this? Which, again, would that's a natural reaction, you know, of anything. You know, it's like, all right, well, you know, can we get out? So.
Yeah. Wow. This has been a mind-blowing, I have to say. I'll say this, okay?
Yeah.
I think there are a lot of things they're not telling us, like with the globe. Maybe the Earth is actually bigger than what they're telling us, and we're on top of a bigger globe. Maybe we're at the very tippy top, and there's
sure.
some kind of dome over it. I mean, that's possible.
Oh, yeah.
I just don't know. All I know is that when you think of the model that they're putting out there, it's incorrect. And if they're willing to fake the moon landing and you know, Sandy Hook and Aurora and God
yeah,
knows
yeah.
what else, you know.
For me, I can summarize it like this, because it made so much sense for me, because, you know, for me, I looked at the moon landing for years, and I had no doubt that there was some huge, huge problems with it. But for me, I had a problem with the motivation, and that was – I came up with a reason. It's like, okay, why do you fake the space program like that? What is in it for you? And I'm thinking, okay, it's national pride, you know, it's USA, go rah-rah. But it wasn't that good. I mean, it was good, but it's like, man, that's a lot of money. So when I finally got into it, you know, it made more sense, because it rephrased the question. And that was more of a statement, really. It's like, look, they didn't want to fake the space program. They had to fake the space program, because if you don't fake it, if you do not militarize and nationalize the space program, then sooner or later you're going to get a private corporation or two or ten, and they're going to get together, you know, like they're even trying to do now, but they would have done it a whole lot earlier, and then, you know, then it's not under your control, you know.
Yeah.
And for those people out there that say, oh, you know, what about satellites? It's like, it's like, really, you're going to ask me that? It's like, you know, go watch the International Space Station videos. Why would you fake the interior of that? There's nobody up there. So if there's nobody up there, then why? Why are you faking? It's like, well, because you have to. You have to give the illusion there's people up there. You have to fake that you're sending probes everywhere. Even the Mars rover, Really? That's been running, what, 5-7 years past its expiration date? No one can explain why. Oh, yeah, the camera's still running. Nobody's talking about it.
Yeah.
But it, for me, you know, again, I went into this trying to debunk it, which is, you know, to date, and, you know, knock on wood here, I haven't gotten any debunkers, but I think it's because I went into this trying to debunk it. So, you know, everything that I put out, I won't put out anything if I can smash it.
Mark, do you think that the space program was debunked because of the political climate of the day, like the Cold War, Russia against America and all that stuff, or?
Oh, you mean the American space program?
Yeah.
No,
you know,
we had to beat
the Russians. You know, they were the first to launch Sputnik, and, you know, they've already supposedly sent a probe to the moon.
Well, yeah. No, I think it was a joint effort because remember, they've been in it together. For me, Russia and America have never been at the highest level. I don't think they've been enemies.
Absolutely.
I think they have been secret brothers. At, you know, people say, oh, the Cold War and, you know, better dead than red and all that crap. It's like, look, these guys have been with us since the beginning. And I won't go in. I know we don't have time for this stuff.
I'll tell you one thing. It was the Rockefellers and Rothschilds that shut down Russia as an economy by turning them communist because they didn't want competition.
Sure. Sure.
And that makes total sense.
Yeah. You know, if our moon mission was successful, you don't think Russia would head to the moon on their own? Oh, well, we're late to the game. We're just not going to go. That's a bunch of crap. Of course they'd go. That they figured out that we could fake it better than they could. And so they just gave up. And I think you know, other people, I think England knew that it was a fake. You know, look at that James Bond movie where Sean Connery's running through the Hollywood movie moon set. You know, that was a little nod, you know.
Well,
to,
you know, it also makes so much sense. Why aren't other governments outing our government that we didn't go, you know, and saying, hey, you guys did that. They're not.
No, they're not. Well, mostly because they're using NASA as a consultant. I mean, look up some fun stuff. Look up Chinese space program bubbles, you know, absolutely China has faked their entire thing and they did it in an underwater simulator, probably ours. You know, they probably rented it out for the day. There's so many – everybody at the highest level. Now, they may not know exactly why they're doing it, you know, because that's a need-to-know basis. But they have been told, it's like, look, every space program, if it's going to be, you know, it's going to seem legit, is going to be fake. And if you're doing your own private program, don't expect success because, you know, we're going to keep you absolutely under thumb. So just my take.
Amazing.
Yeah. It's not – people is not what you think is – or the argument, you know, and it was – I've said this before, but I'm going to say it again. Tell me how you are living on a globe – convince me that you're living on a globe without using the word NASA. If you can do that, then you might have something.
And it's so true. If you look at all the pictures of Earth, they're all the same, just about, or composites.
Yeah, the composite images, the one image, and you know, I know we're running out of time, but I got to say this. Look, I completely missed this 15 years ago, where when I was doing a search online for the pictures of the Earth from space, there was literally one shot showing the bottom part of Africa and the entire part of Antarctica. And it was literally, there was no other pictures online. And it was the year 2000. And it just blew my mind. But, you know, at the same time, it's because we're conditioned not to make the leap. What was the first thing I was going to think? Flat Earth? No, of course not. I was going to think that NASA just is way behind in their game. And it's like, well, you guys got to get these images up faster because this stuff's 40 years old. And it's because there was nothing else to send. They don't know how to fake it. It's getting too hard. The internet hive mind picks up details. You can't hide anything on the internet anymore. You can't do it. Which is I'm trying to tell them if they're listening to this right now. Look, stop faking stuff. You can't do it.
I was told in a dream 2 nights ago to not touch the subject. So just so you know.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
I should have got into that earlier.
Well, it's
so Mark, we're down to 3 minutes, 2 minutes. Why don't you plug your website? Not your website. Your plug your information. Yeah, how to get a hold of you and, you know, your YouTube videos and the names.
Okay, yeah. It's real easy. You could Google this or you can just throw it on YouTube. It's Flat Earth Clues. I'm the only one doing them. And you'll see a series of 9 clues and the Flat Earth Guide, which I recommend first. It goes through, you know, there's a playlist. You can go through all of them and it doesn't take that long. It is the, in my opinion, not, you know, even though it is the last conspiracy people look at, it is, you know, the mother of all conspiracies. It is so big that the conspiracy itself has been buried to where we are conditioned to laugh at it. And I'm the perfect example. I laughed at this thing for years. You know, I just snicker and say, oh, this is a religious thing. This is something else. It is absolutely real. I have no doubt in my mind, and I am going to do everything I can to see if I can find someone out there knows someone who can, you know, because it only takes just a small fragment to, because, you know, it's so fragile. You know, it's a secret that cannot be kept forever because we're living in it. It's not like the other conspiracies where you can bury it, you know, under Groom Lake forever. You know, no one's going to find out. This is right. Something that I believe they also have a contingency for. It's like, you know, one day if enough people find out, well, we'll see what happens there. I would imagine some sort of huge event distraction. But you cannot keep a secret like this forever. It is physically impossible. It's like hiding something from your roommates in the apartment.
I'm sorry. And what's that map again, that Peterson?
The one they're trying to get into schools is the Gall-Peters map.
That is an amazing map.
Yeah.
And, you know,
yeah.
I was looking at that today and it still like blows my mind because we're so conditioned to the Mercator map, right?
Yeah, yeah.
That when you look at the Peterson map, it's like, holy cow, man.
Yeah.
Look at that, you know?
That should be the gateway to a perception thing for you because, look, they're not lying about that. That's the Gall-Peters map. That's the proportion of what the Earth looks like. And they didn't tell you that for, hundreds of years. So if that's wrong, you know, if the map you've been looking at in school has been wrong, then what else is wrong? And right. I'm going all the way and saying, look, the whole world is wrong. They've hidden the world entirely. It's a clever con, but it's worked.
Well, Mark, you've said it all. This has been Parlay. Mark, this has been a great, great interview despite the phone call interruption that I got.
Sorry about that. No worries. Thank you very much, Mark.
I want to thank you. Stay tuned. Don't go away. We'll be right back on CJ Myres Radio. This is Parlay. I'm your host, Mike Gray.